Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us. I have the pleasure of being joined today again by returning guest Dimitri Halley. Dimitri, welcome back.
Thank you, Evita, and it's always a pleasure to share with you.
Likewise, Dimitri, it's been fantastic having you on. I know we've been getting into some fascinating topics and conversations that, while they are able to expand, you know, our consciousness, raise our level of awareness, they also touch upon something so much bigger within ourselves and within what is taking place on our planet today when it comes to the evolution of and expansion of consciousness, when it comes to the awakening. So for anyone who is not familiar with your work and perhaps is joining us for the first time on this third part episode that we are doing together, Dimitri is a clinical and organizational psychologist and founder of the Dimitri Halley Center. He is a depth psychologist at the individual and collective levels and professor in the psychology of paranormal phenomena. He studies the deeper reality of quantum physics, spirituality, and is an expert in dream analysis. And in our first part, we focused, for anybody who missed that, on the work of the shadow and how much you, again, helped us understand how important this work is, especially for us to get to know ourselves and transform so much of, you know, the suffering, the ego and limiting mind patterns, etc. In our second video episode, you shared with us about the personal nature of dreams. And today we are getting into the collective nature of dreams and shared dreaming. Of course, there's our personal perceptions, but there's also the collective awareness, the collective consciousness. And that's what we will be looking into today through the nature of your dream work and research in this area. So Dimitri, when it comes to understanding and moving from the level of personal to collective dreams, help us understand this. How are we? Is there, you know, a pattern, a stairway of sorts?
Yes. Well, exactly. One would look at it like an onion, and then it's like peeling off the layers of the onion. So it starts at an individual level, which is what you just spoke about, was the shadow work and the individual dreams. It basically, Evita, it's really... I recently gave a workshop on the Fibonacci cycle or spiral, what is also called like the fingerprint of God. It's the basic structure of nature, like the roses and the shell.
Like fractals, yeah. Also.
Yes, exactly. It's almost, it's really what the way nature is designed. And so you can see like the stages, like the Fibonacci. And in terms of the spiral of a shell, so each cycle, each spiral goes deeper and deeper and deeper into towards the center, you know, like a rose. That is really like the different layers of the onion. As we go up this stairway, which is really the spiral, we start peeling off the layers, and the first layers are the layers of the what we have spoken about as being the observation problem, really. You know, so where we really are like caught in projections, basically. So we're like veiled from the deeper levels of that Fibonacci or the onion, cut off from that, which is what I call the collective levels. And we're really stuck in our own projections. And so the first layer, the first stages is becoming what I call step, when you're too close to step back, to reflect, to realize that what we're seeing out there in first instance is really our own projections. Mm. And when we can see that and become aware, thus, for instance, that what I'm perceiving out there is really a result of the state that I am in. And when I can like take that back, so then see, then I start to like peel the layers of the onion and to go ever deeper into my inward, into the self. As you start to go deeper and deeper into yourself, meaning being aware of your own projections, you really start to go to a deeper layer beyond what I would call space and time, which is where we tend to get caught in this illusion of separateness. When we take that back, most people come to me with problems regarding their surrounding. You know, what do I do with this or that person? And it's really, there is no way to solve the problems in terms of the stage itself, you know, like Einstein said, that we need to really like change the channel, because once you're caught in that outer layer, it's really a kind of a damned if you do and damned if you don't kind of thing. But as we peel the onion, it's like shifting channel. As the bandwidth becomes smaller, narrower, we change channel. So we like move out of a certain channel into another channel where things are, where we are not in that reality, where we are where we think we're separate from the surrounding. You can see these layers of the onion or the Fibonacci as also layers of reality that people are like caught in, or I call them channels. Mm. You see, if we reality is really more informational than Newtonian, so it's really the idea of channels and dialing into other channels is really a powerful way of speaking to this. So as we start to take back these projections, and I call it, as we are able to remain longer periods into what I call the third person perspective, you know, so where we're looking at ourselves in terms of ourselves and not just looking at the world, you know, like something independent of us, then that's where we start to, in the dreams, connect to the self with a capital S. But at that point, we're really quite into the onion, into the spiral, you know? And the spiral is really going ever more inward, because it's inward, it's that going inward that helps us to, as it were, dial into the what I would call then the deep, the collective unconscious, which would then be like a deeper space and time, where things are not separate anymore. So once we connected this, the self with the capital S, mm-hmm. is like towards the center of the onion, where the self is not anymore separated in opposites. You know, so it's also in that, towards the core, that you really get access to what you would call like the real stuff, ability to choose, to really think, to not, you know, to really, so it's that's where the real stuff is. When we're on the outskirts of the onion, we're really not, we're in a state of compartmentalization. So we don't have access to the faculties of the mind that are at the core, you know, where we're whole again. So the self with a capital S really is like the password to the collective unconscious, which would then be like the quantum level of the mind or the spiritual level. That's where the shared dreaming occurs, you know, at the deeper layers of the onion.
As we go deeper in, this makes me think that we on the inside go deeper and deeper within, as you keep explaining, whether it's the shell, the fractal, the onion. But in a sense, we're able to get a wider picture perspective of all that is. So it's like, you know, again, that analogy, that picture comes in where the deeper we go here, the more we actually are able to see and perceive here, where it's not just, you know, isolated problems then in our life, in our world, but then we start seeing those massive connections for what's driving the collective manifestations.
Exactly. That's exactly it, because the more we go inward, the more we actually transcend the observation problem, which is what keeps us in these little boxes, you know, the little individual, the little ego boxes. At the depths of the self, of the onion, that inwardness is really, that's where we start to connect to the idea of as within, as without. Mm. So, you know, so that's where we really start to reconnect to the real world, you know, the real reality. As long as we're caught in like a sensorial take, mm-hmm. we're like in an illusion. So these, so the collective dreams is like, it's almost like awakening to the real world where we are actually one with everything. And when we're in the, on the outskirts of the onion, we're really caught in a sense of separateness, which is not what nature is. You know, nature is really, we are the real, our true connection to nature is where everything is really one. So right, we're really going inward as a means to connect to the real picture.
You know, this is amazing synchronicity, because I was, the last guest was speaking about the great field and basically sharing what you're saying, but from a different angle of how separation and judgment keeps us again stuck on those outskirts, right? And so right. We see, we experience so many of the different tragedies, so-called tragedies in our world, or various problems, whatever we define as problems in our life. And we judge, you know, self-criticize others, problems, etc. And we keep that ourselves stuck in that state of separateness, yeah. where everything you're sharing here is, again, to go deeper, to heal yeah. ourselves to a greater understanding that yes. we're so much more, that, and that life is so much more, not just these isolated events.
Exactly. So when we say deeper, you need to see it that when we, so we are like caught in a, the illusion is that we tend to be caught in this world of what they call the macro world mm-hmm. of particles, but we know that that reality is really a wave function. So where there's no, where everything is one. So somehow the senses keep us caught in that particle state. So So going inward is really going, accessing a wave state connection to things, which is right in front of our eyes, very eyes, but that because of that constant judgment, we tend to be locked out of it. So the idea of the stairway or the spiral is that, so when I say being able to sustain the third person perspective in ever longer runs, what I'm really saying is indeed a state of superposition where we are not judging anymore. Mm-hmm. And judging is not only judging. Judging is the very act of observing with the senses. Because observing means that when I see the world as something loose or separate from me. So it's that state of first person awareness where I am observing things as separate of me. Collectively, us being locked in that state is locking us out of the wave state and into this particle level.
So when you're speaking about the third person perspective, again, from various disciplines, even from the studies of Buddhism, etc., there's always this aspect of detachment, or, you know, there's the notion that there's suffering when we attach, regardless to if it's pleasure or pain. How does this all come in and fit together?
No, and that's exactly it. In the stairway that I use, mm-hmm. and I have discovered, if you wish, the first step is called two clothes, which is the Buddhist attachment, and the second step is step back, which is to detach. The problem is that in Western thought, the detachment sometimes is regarded as a kind of a indifference, you know. Mm-hmm. It's really going between the opposites, you know, transcending the opposites. So it's like, I would explain it like stepping back, but not letting go.
Right.
You see, so, and it's a paradoxical take,
yeah.
But right, it's all about that. And the stepping back would mean that we would eventually let go of the world in terms of something out there. And the going inward into this spiral would mean that we would reawaken in a world where we are one with it. So you see, it's the complete opposite. Mm-hmm. So at the outskirts of the Fibonacci, we really, everything like turns upside down. Because we tend to sense everything is out there,
mm-hmm.
you know, and while at the center of the onion, the sense of reality is very much that I am creating what is around me, you know. So I'm in my experience of reality. I'm not excluded from it.
Yeah, and you know, that's a very important point as well, because it reminds us to stay engaged with life. Again,
exactly.
Not the same as attached or detached, but a different state of being.
Right.
So as we go deeper, at first we get fascinated, you know, by ourselves, our dreams, our personal observations, but then we go deeper and deeper and we start to, you know, hit, if I can say, the space of the collective, psyche, of the collective dreams. How do we know we've come there? If somebody's, you know, just listening and saying, well, okay, I'm going, you know, I'm doing my inner work, etc. But is there something to look for, some clues?
Yeah, well, that's it. What we really discovered is the self with a capital S is you're going to start to enter the abode of the self once you do enough work on integrating yourself. And you must do dream work to do that, because there's a lot of the unconscious that is not conscious, obviously, mm-hmm. you know. So you're not going to get there just with your conscious mind. But once you start, indeed, what I call touch the shadow and be able to stay for long periods in superposition or in a state of non-judgmental awareness, then you're going to connect to the self, and then you're going to start to realize that you're going to start to have dreams, Ifira, that are actually, and this is the heart and soul of the method, you're going to enter the collective unconscious, meaning that the dreams at that level are actually like letters of a word, of which your dream is just one letter and the other person's dream is another letter, but only by fitting that puzzle together you get the meaning or the strings. So yes, a lot of people, because they don't know this, have been doing a lot of the work, have been having these collective dreams, but they don't know.
Mm-hmm.
The idea is this: what you're basically downloading at that point from the wave state, or which, if we can later get into that, which is like you from your own prophecy, because that's the only words to put this in,
mm-hmm.
or your vision, your true purpose, is you're going to be downloading like little pieces of the your vision, your prophecy, you know, your purpose. The problem is with that stage is that it's collective. So most people don't know that they need to find, and it's not finding like what you do outskirts of onion, you know, this frantic looking for stuff. You will attract this tribe into your life.
Mm.
See, you already have contact with them. But you're going to attract at that level a kind of a tribe into your life, and they are also probably dreaming with this vision. So it's really great stuff for workshops, because mm-hmm. only when you put these dreams together as a group, as a team,
mm-hmm.
then you get glimpses of this vision that you are part of. You see, because it's not just the self, and its vision is not just individual. Obviously, you know, you're not here. You cannot. The vision always mm-hmm. is collective. Cause you can't just live your vision alone. You know, you're going to need others, and it's going to be a team effort. It's these words, and it's finding these words. It's really putting together these dreams of the several people around you. And what you're going to then do is it's like making puzzles. Each individual dream is like a little painting.
Mm-hmm.
And when you put them together, you get a big painting that makes sense. You see? And when you do that, then that's the way it works. And so once you complete these bigger paintings, that's also the very way this cloud is collapsed into reality. Then you start. So then that starts to unfold around you, this vision. As you see it, you create it. Mm-hmm. So as you become aware of it, it starts to unfold in your life. And that's really this the next stage, what James Redfield also referred to in terms of the 11th insight in the Celestine Prophecy. If you look good, it all goes back to Jung, because the 12 steps of the AA is a derivative of Jung. Bill Johnson was in therapy by Jung. And then you have the Celestine Prophecy is also actually Jungian. You know, it's a kind of a translation of Jung. It's all going back to Jung and synchronicity. So that vision that this group starts to access and dream in terms of shared dreaming, that unfolds in reality in terms of synchronicities. So Jung is like the Merlin of Europe. It all goes back to him.
You know, it's fascinating, and I'm sure anybody who's listening is thinking, so it's like a treasure hunt, it's like detective work. Yes. We can, of course, make it very fun and such. So let's talk a little bit. I know we're going to get into your research, what you found with shared dreaming and how this plays out, let's say just in a laboratory setting. But if people are wondering, okay, so who are these others? Are they strangers? Or can they be my family, my friends? Do I just start talking about dreams? Like, is there a practical aspect here that you could help us with?
You will basically start to dream with these others at that level. They will enter your dreams, and so you will, and then you will, at some point, you will connect to them in real life, which happens in a very synchronistic way. You know, because it's a kind of a law of attraction kind of thing. You know, so it's all about starting to identify these people at this level of your dreams, and then to recognize them in real life. Because it's with these people that you have a task, a shared task on the planet. That's the way it really happens. And it's and so everybody that completes these steps on the stairway, which is like the first stages of the dream work, everybody enters that stage, and then you need to download the dreams regarding this, and then start identify this tribe, and then together you guys tend to then be able to download the vision or the prophecy that you belong to. You see, Evita, this is like almost the game. The scavenger hunt game, it's literally a scavenger hunt, because you get clues and then you need to solve them, and then you need to make these pictures, these puzzles, which we call cards or words. Whenever you complete these words, then you download more words. And each word then becomes like pieces of a sentence and sentences of a story. It's really a tale. So you start to like download this tale that you belong to. And as you are able to piece it together, it starts to unfold around you in your life as a story. You see, and this, Evita, is the way we transcend, or that's the passage from what we would call the outskirts of the onion, which would be then this matrix Cartesian space and time where where opposites are separate. And then this is the transition to the new space-time, where the opposites are like pairs, so which we would call the infinite space-time. You see, this is the transition to a new world. This is also why this shared dreaming is seamlessly connecting to prophecies around the world. The idea of a prophecy or a myth is where you are not anymore caught in the idea that you're the observer and out there is the observed. In the prophecy or the myth, you enter your own story. See, so that's the only way to really know reality beyond the observation problem, is in terms of finding and entering your own myth. The myth is like the reality where you are not excluded from the observation. Mm-hmm. You see, so all of these indigenous peoples that are almost like, one could say, like those that haven't made partaken of the fall, they live in a mythical view. You know, they live in a myth. So, but this is like the next step, because this is the only way we can really know reality beyond the observation problem. And the modern physics is trying to know reality beyond the observation problem, but in a very mechanical way, mm-hmm. of, you know, like, it's almost like going ever more in a state of detachment. But this is the way that we have discovered that is the natural way to return to a new world view, you know, where I am at the center of my own story.
And we'll be talking more about, you know, the fascinating and the implications of how this can again play out even more in our life. But you've mentioned a few times the idea of, you know, the letters, that, for example, I have a piece of the puzzle or a letter, somebody else, etc., which brings us into the topic of language of dreams, right? Because we've touched upon this in our last episode when it comes to learning our personal language, but now we're dealing on a collective level. How is this language different or unique in this sense?
Yes, well, and that really goes very, very deep, but it's exactly, these words are actually what has been revealed like a quantum language. Mm. You know, it's really it's a whole new dimension in language, which has not been discovered yet, because we have been very much busy with the particles level of language, you know, looking at a whole different, but so this, yes, these words are really part of what I would almost say in physics, it would be comparable to the string theory, mm-hmm. because what string is really telling us is that at the deeper levels of the wave state, we get like a leap from towards sounds, where reality is made up of sounds, you know, primordial sounds, not anymore mm-hmm. things. So this takes us really back to the Vedas, where we know that in the Vedas, language was still completely primordial before the separation occurred. You see, the Vedas is where sound and meaning and color, it's all still united. Mm-hmm. You know, so where the shapes and the meaning are still connected. So it's really a level of chanting. It's a level of music. It's really music. What we're getting, what we're finding, Evita, at the level of these words, which is what where this dreaming occurs, is where we're hitting back on the what you would call like the level of the primordial sounds, and these words form larger like sounds or stories. These stories are sounds, and together they take us back to what you would then almost say is the primordial sound or the Om. Mm-hmm. But the Om, the primordial sound Om would then be like the collective story that we all become part of when all these groups and these tribes started not only find their own individual tribes, but when these tribes start to find each other, and then you get like they keep ever more going into one more collective vision or story and one bigger story till you find like the story of the planet, of the earth. Mm-hmm. And that would then be like reconnecting to the Om, the original creational sound. And at that point, we really, together with, if you wish, Creator or the Sophia, would complete the creation. So it's almost like you would have a Big Bang, and then you have this, a particle creation, and then, or the caterpillar, and then we would together complete the creation with that, with the sound, you see? So this is why I remember when I was discovering all of this, I had a this, all of this comes to me in dreams, Evita. I could never think this up, you know? I remember one dream was saying that at the center of the cycle, where we find this core story, it said music, it was referring to it in terms of music, and it then said that music is the physics of the mind. So what we find at that primordial level of nature is music. The way we have translated that original language, one would almost say the language that God speaks. Mm-hmm. And we are all like little parts of that, almost like a shadow in terms of plateau of what that original music or the true language really was. It's really the way these words connect, mm-hmm. these letters connecting into words is a rhyming of meaning. So synchronicity is really a rhyming of meaning. So when we put these words together, these letters together in these shared dreams, we're really discovering rhymes. And with these rhymes, we're uncovering this deeper world or space-time that was hidden from us mm-hmm. when we fell into that particle state. This is why the closer we get to this, if you wish, this prophecy or this collective vision, it's literally like connecting to this music. So this, it's like this music that is calling us back to this, one could say, this original states or city where the selves abode. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's like one would say that it's really what you would call heaven, but and I call it a Cirque du Soleil without the strings. So it's really it's like they really come very close to that. The Cirque du Soleil, you know, their whole, it's magical. But I actually saw it, but then you without the strings, because mm-hmm. in that space-time, there is no limitations, you know. The word Om, Evita, means the infinite, the unbounded. This is why all of these chants in Buddhism, all these mantras, they all start with Om. Mm-hmm. But what it means is that before every word, you put the word infinite. Because that deeper space-time where the sheer dreaming happens is like the land of infinite possibilities.
In these collective dreams, if I'm a part of them, am I actually dreaming in sound? Because sometimes, you know, we do have language in our dreams, etc. Would somebody be dreaming more musical tones, or would they still be dreaming conversations with people? Does the sound aspect change in our dreams, or is this all more, you know, figurative?
Well, you know, both. But actually, see, but the thing is that the music, so the transition to the, really to the dimension that they refer to as the primordial sounds, mm-hmm. The story itself is the music. So like, a story is really a form of visualized music. The story that you enter is itself the music.
Right.
And obviously at that level, you are in a completely telepathic reality. I would appear in the dreams of this tribe that I am part of, you know, systematically, if I can stay in superposition. So yes, so that's the nature of it. But obviously also that same vision that is like the visualized song, it's a song. You can also hear it, obviously. You know? Like someone had a dream that whenever they would approximate the self with a capital S, which is true healing, and thus also connecting with this vision, they would hear a certain song or music. That's also a way to know that you are connecting to it. There's mm-hmm. certain, you know, because so this is absolutely and completely incredible, Evita, because whenever I work with this collective dreams, it's almost like the feeling is that you really enter into this story. It's almost like you're seeing a story in these dreams, but you're also in it. And the feeling is that you really go into another dimension. And yeah, it's incredible. And it's so that vision or that prophecy is completely magical and very powerful. It's able to, the word would be almost like rapture you mm-hmm. into a whole nother dimension. It's absolutely ecstasy. So when you can put these words together, because you actually at that point it's almost like you're entering a movie.
Yeah.
You know? It's so that's also why I think that this is actually the way, this is what a lot of these prophetic traditions have refer to as the rapture. But maybe we can get into some of that a little bit later.
Absolutely, because I'd also love to ask you and have you share with the audience, what is this, you know, looking like in terms of your research right now? I know you've mentioned at times that, you know, there's connection almost to like the movie Inception, where people go into layers and layers of, you know, depth of their subconscious mind, etc., and they can actually coalesce and co-create together at the dream level. What is, you know, your take on all this, and what is have been some of your findings with respect to your research with participants?
Yeah, well, exactly. What we have found is that at that level, these groups or these tribes, they do missions together. They go on missions, you know. They go on, there's certain tasks and certain missions that they perform together in the dreams at this level. It's very, very similar to Inception. Hmm. And so this is obviously stuff, Evita, that you could never think it up, you know.
Yeah.
These movies are, it's impossible to just think it up. This is all, I think, stuff that people are actually really discovering, you know. The difference is the two timelines.
Yes.
Because it's very, very intimately related to the whole domain of remote viewing and all of that, you know, and lucid dreaming. But the work that I am doing, which I think is like going to the center of the onion, it's not in any way intruding or prying on or putting any kind of inceptioning any thoughts into anybody's mind and all of that, you know? It's not, absolutely not about that. Also, obviously at this level, we are lucid dreaming because we are like aware that we are dreaming, but it's also not in terms of controlling the dream.
Yes.
You know, so that's the whole thing. There is another timeline, if you wish, that is trying to work this out, but in maybe in a different way, you know, like to use it in for other means. But it is strictly and totally towards entering the prophecy. And the prophecy is like, or the story is taking us where we need to go, you know. So it's non-manipulative, and it's completely in terms of fostering the collective story.
Yeah,
you know, which is supposed to like take us back to another space, another place. But it's very similar. The two, let me just say this: the two timelines look so much alike that to a lot of people, it's indistinguishable from each other.
Now, two quick things is, of course, for anybody who might be thinking this is too far-fetched, this stuff only happens in movies, I just want to bring up the point that, you know, this has actually, research like this has been taking place on our planet in one way or another. Great example is if you're familiar with Bob Monroe and the Monroe Institute, and even Thomas Campbell, the NASA physicist, how they got into actually going out of body and sharing remote, you know, realities and remote viewing and such. So
Right. What
you're sharing is possible, absolutely.
Yeah.
It just depends on, you know, how deep we go, etc. And,
exactly.
And you know, yes, absolutely, I too can relate to what you're saying in terms of there's no control at that level. The control, if anything, is at this level. You know, the media, for example, does enough inception into our minds.
Exactly.
You know, at that level, because there's such a heightened state of awareness, it's a completely different game. So,
exactly.
Fascinating stuff, Dimitri.
Exactly.
So when we speak about, of course, we've mentioned this splitting of the timelines a few times now, as well as the idea of myths, of prophecies. Yes, we've been, you know, privy to all sorts of those, especially in the last few years and decades. The Armageddon idea, the rapture idea that you've mentioned, the Hopi prophecy of splitting timelines as well. Is this all collective in terms of all the, you know, what is it, 8 billion people on our planet today? Or is it more group collective, as what you're perhaps getting at, with our own tribes and building our own prophecies?
What we have been finding is that at a certain point, the real indigenous big prophecies, they tend to all connect.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because it's inherent in the whole idea that you're going ever more towards one singularity or one story, you know?
Yeah.
The universe, which is like the Om, the one verse, and that is like the big vision of creation, you know? And so, yeah, so all of these, and what we have been finding is that these tribes are really connecting to this one prophecy, which is called the world myth. Each and every one, obviously, the idea would be that each tribe would find their way as a tribe to wherever they need to be, mm-hmm. you know. But at some point, all of these tribes are going to connect, mm. you know, in terms of this bigger vision. And the other timeline is, in the idea would be, Evita, that the same way you can go into the center of the onion, inward. So the inward is not just inward individually, it's inward to the core of reality. The same way you can go outward, and the other timeline would be the stream of time that is going ever more outward, you know, ever more looking for it outside of the individual. Mm-hmm. You know, so then you would get, like, for instance, CERN would be also looking at what we are looking at in terms of the collective unconscious, but in terms of like particles, you know, trying to mm-hmm. find the God particle. And in our terms, the God particle would be the self inside, you know, where you're the photon. But there is a stream of classical science that is really going ever more outside of the cycle, the spiral, sorry. And at a certain point, obviously, thus, one can just... It's a logical reasoning. If one side is going ever more inward and the other side is going ever more outward, a point comes of a kind of a split, you know, like mm-hmm. The way a cell division occurs. Mm-hmm. That's, as it were, where it seems that the side that's going inward is going to, if you wish, connect to a parallel universe within the onion, which we are already entering in terms of this vision, or what we would call the collective unconscious. And the other side would go also towards a kind of a parallel via the singularity. And so there seems to be like a division. Mm-hmm. But the idea would be that neither side can stop each other. And that's also absolutely not the purpose. You know, the idea would be that it's not like a matter of saying, oh my God, you know, this other timeline is really going downward of the stairway towards a whole different world, which is completely unnatural, you know, very robotic and machine-like, the one going back to the inner of the onion is really going back to true nature. It's really going back to nature, of which we have been like cut off, really. I feel that it should not be, we shouldn't demonize each other, mm-hmm. you know?
Just take your path, whichever one you resonate with, right? And
yes.
Let the other be.
Yes, you know, and there is, they are going to be so removed from each other in terms of frequencies that they're not even going to, like, some of us that are already going deep into the core, it's already the feel. We already have like a very succinct feeling that there are like two worlds on this planet already. You know, there's this side that is really reuniting with nature,
yeah.
And there's the side that is going ever more in a kind of a artificial intelligence nature, which is not nature. You know, so but at a certain point, they will maybe split. And I get a lot of critique for this, by the way.
Oh, really?
Well, you know, because no one likes it. It doesn't sound nice that there will be like a splitting, you know,
yeah.
But
I think it's just, I don't know, to me, it's very harmless because, okay, so you like the color blue, let's say I like the color red. So what? So you choose to live in a blue world, I choose to live in a red world. There need not be any, you know, anything wrong with that. Just, and this is what I find we actually do have a huge challenge with on planet Earth, is not being okay with the differences of the other. We seem to want to make everybody think like us, be like us, dress like us, eat like us. It's okay. It's okay. So I completely resonate with what you're saying, because I've been speaking to many people as well who are saying, what is happening? Like, you know, the challenges seem to be increasing, because yes, there's this shift in frequencies where it's, sometimes I almost have to say, you know, it's becoming a little tougher to relate, because it's like we're talking about two different things, pick any topic. And it's just, so it is quite fascinating. But one thing too, I think is very important to note here is, you know, in the last few years, again, with the whole 2012 coming and the prophecies and such, many people expected this sort of splitting of the worlds. But they expected it was just going to, you know, I think it was the idea of also the going into the fifth dimension. They expected that it would just happen and take some and not others, even the rapture, the Christian views, etc. But what I'm hearing from you, and I'm hoping everybody else is as well, is that it's not automatic. You need to do the work based on which, you know, timeline you're moving into. It's not just going to be like you sit back, relax, and it just happens to you. We need to do the work.
Exactly, and that's why this process of finding the self, and then what I would call like the new name, mm-hmm. you know, because that's like almost like a password to transcend to this space and time where things are not as disconnected as it is here, you know.
Exactly.
And I actually had it the other day. I had like in my dream I saw this. So it's going to go very. Unnoticeable, you know, you're almost not going to even notice that you're in that other field. But I was standing in the woods, and all of a sudden I looked next to me and I saw this woman, but she was like covered in horse hair. She was somehow a horse and a woman, but beautiful. But she was like covered, and then, but she would like Aruba is very much like Arizona, like a lot of cacti and stuff, you know, we have a lot of cactus, and she was like moving on top of the cactus. We have these awesome, beautiful cactus here, like these huge big, and she was moving on top of these. But this is the thing I wanted to share, Evita. She would move in a way that was so fluent and so rhythmic that other people couldn't see her, but she was right there. And when I woke, the what was told to me is that she was like an elemental. She was like the spirit of nature. What I saw was that when we are still in that space-time matrix where we're still very much caught in the first-person perspective, which means at a very low frequency, you cannot see that deeper space-time because it's so fluent and so rhythmic. So I posted a piece the other day that going beyond the space of time is not speed. Mm-hmm. It's rhythm. Mm. So, you know, so as we go deeper into nature, what we are going to be discovering is that nature consists really of these incredible rhythms that we are not even able to perceive yet at this level. And I could see her, but I could also see that she was moving so fluently that I could barely see her. But because I am like entering back into that deeper space-time, we are starting to see that what is nature, what is really in front of us is a complete different, deeper. Yeah. It's almost like, you know, moving the veil.
So Dimitri, can you talk about then how the cycles are also influencing the world myths and how those two play out together?
So what we know that time, Evita, time is actually what they call the Uroboric cycle, mm-hmm. of descent and ascent. We are at the end of that cycle, and it's mm-hmm. not, you know, it's taking it really literal to say that it's the December 2012. That's like really, you know, it's not that. It's whenever... It's this group connecting, reconnecting to this vision and this prophecy that ends the cycle. You see what I'm saying? It's not going, as you said with the rapture, it's not going to end from 1 minute to the next. It's we are going to end it. And but that's what I've been referring to as the world myth. Uroboric means the serpent that bites its own tail. So we are at that end point, which is the beginning. So we are transitioning into a new template of time, which is circular, which is not anymore triangular, you know?
Right.
We are going back to a template or an archetype where everything is going to become back circular, meaning there is no more divisions and disconnections. And this seems to be a universal cycle. So this is not like, in a way, depending on any individual. It's almost like the universe is completing this cycle and we are all part of making it happen, but it's not like, you know, it's not going to happen.
Yeah.
You see, and so that it's that cycle that is ending. The idea would be that we need to get into this collective level to be able to survive or transition to that next step. Because imagine going back into a world where everything is circular, but you are still in a very disjointed pyramidal structure. The pyramid is really a symbol of a phallic symbol of the male that has disconnected from the female. You know, this is why probably all of these things that we are discovering as part of what Atlantis used to be, they're all pyramids. Because that channel of reality becomes so overheated.
Yeah.
This is why the movie in the Hunger Games is called Catching a Fire. The outer level of the onion is on fire. We eat acid. You know, everything about that timeline is fire.
Inflammation.
You know,
yep.
Inflammation, exactly. Radiation, inflammation, acid. The diet is completely acidic. It's almost like drinking in acid. You know, the red meat and all of that. And eventually that bandwidth will be compensated. There will be a compensation because if there's too much fire, there will be a flood. There will be water to cool it off. So this is why Atlantis ended up underwater. It's the way the earth is going to cool itself off. But those at the center of the onion are not going to be part of that. They are going to transition to another reality level. And the other timeline will go from that extremely fiery state to something completely different.
Mm-hmm.
But so yes, there is a level of that surface of the onion that is very fragmented and will be compensated.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but so the earth, what we see in these earth phenomena is the mother trying to heal itself.
Exactly. So speaking of the realness factor of it, and of course the prophecies, etc., what can you leave the audience with in terms of, okay, so I want to do this work. Yes, I've already been working on the going inner, paying attention to the dreams. Let's say somebody's thinking all this. What next steps do you advise to people?
So look, so what we have uncovered, because it's almost at the heart and soul of every mystery school or secret tradition, you know, like even in Masonry or in the Rosicrucians or whatever, it all revolves around the stairway. You know, that's like everybody is basically agreeing upon the fact that Fibonacci is what it's, that spiral is what it's all about. So what you have is you have these steps. You know, this is the concrete way we need to work this. And then so it starts with this being too attached to things and then stepping back or letting go and then reflecting. It's all about reflecting in the middle stages. It's all about reflection,
mm-hmm.
contemplation, you know. All of the great traditions agree on this. Nowadays, you have that corporations give one day a week to do to contemplate, you know. It should be built into the fabric of the organization that we need to always be in reflection, mm-hmm. reflective mode. That's why most organizations are very ill, Evita, very sick, because there is not in, there is no reflection whatsoever, you know. So then the reflection is that stage of the shadow work, and it's really going, that's the first steps of going inwards, when you start to take back your projections, your judgments, when you're able to go, there's a part of that, that going inward where you need, you have to revisit the crime side, okay, meaning where your individual split ensued. Until you don't really go back to the childhood crime side, you have not decompressed. The word is decompressing. This work of going to the center of the spiral is it's called decompression, meaning it's going out of the compression or the tension. It's going into an ever more relaxed state of peace. So it's the decompression, and that image is beautiful because it means that we're going out of that lower density, high density, lower frequency sea of pieces where everything is separate. We're emerging out of that. So it's called like, it's like a diver, a deep sea diver, we're decompressing. And then you go into the relax, which is where you're completely inward, you know, where almost anything happening around you, you deal with it in a very inward way.
Yeah.
So you become, your gaze becomes very inward oriented. You know, that's where you see the Buddha that looks at his own nose. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So the gaze is very, the attention, which outward becomes intention. You see, so there we're already gearing up, and the energy is being recycled. This is true sustainability. It's sustaining your chi. And then you start to go into that relaxed state, which is like a 0 point, where there's no more tension. And that is your entrance into that collective unconscious, which is like a new space and time, which starts now. Like the woman that I saw, that's here.
Yes.
It starts now. It's not like going to some, you know, that reality, that island is landing here, which they call paradise. And then the step to that level changes. There, the game rules change, because there, so the first stage is very much psychotherapy. Then the second stage is very much awareness and contemplative practices, very much like Buddhism. The first stages is a combination of Taoism and Jungian psychology. And then you get from that contemplative state, then you go to the collective, which, and then it becomes very much faith-bound, faith-based. Because faith or belief and the piecing together of these words, the vision, is what collapses that vision into our reality. So there's a whole new work involved of learning how to let go and to have faith. Mm-hmm. You can train that. So that's actually a training, because then you learn to navigate on that inner sense, not anymore on the outer. You see, then so Evita, it says it, that's where the two worlds already are really parting, because all of that stuff that is being put on the internet and, you know, all of this fear stuff, it's still, obviously it's still in the background somewhere, like affecting us, but as Jung said, when we're awake, we're asleep, and when we're asleep, we're awake. So then we're really into that world that we have, that we see in our dreams, and that we have been collapsing out of the dreams. And then the world of the senses is becoming ever more not really real, to the point, and this is the core of it, to the point where those deeper collective dreams not only become synchronicities, but where that becomes the real, and what the five senses see becomes the dream. You know, and but that is, all of that is very much faith, religious process, not the church based,
yes,
but, you know, so it's very much prayer and faith power that unfolds that field, which James Redfield calls that the prayer fields. But then the prayer is the, or the faith is the belief in these dreams come true. And the faith then becomes this extremely profound confidence in the self. So it's not like a faith belief in something
outside of you, yeah.
Right. This is faith in my true self and in my dreams. These are obviously not dreams anymore.
Yeah.
This is the dreams in terms of the Aboriginals and the Hopis, and these are prophecies.
Mm-hmm.
You know. So and then we self fulfill that. So, but that's really the steps to do this.
Fascinating, Dimitri. And I just, again, love so much what you've just shared, because again, it's so many others are coming at it too, pointing inwards for us, pointing at us, that it's that inner knowing, again, knowing here with a capital K, trusting the self, having faith in the self, again, self here with the capital S, that we're not just talking about these very surface level ideas. This goes so, so much deeper beyond, again, as you mentioned, there's faith. Yes, it becomes almost, you know, like a very deep-seated belief, but nothing to do with the religions as we know it. So many profound things get just, you know, accessed when we start to, again, go into the depths that you are talking
yes.
about.
And Evita, the more we go inward, the more the action is in the mind, you know, it's because you become very proactive in
yeah.
being able to. There's like this whole, it's called the golden compass.
Mm-hmm.
You see that a lot of these concepts are, you find it all over in all of these secret fraternities and so also, because what you learn is how to become very self-reflective
yeah.
in terms of this self-compass. So you become, it's almost like you are activating a new sense. So the sixth sense, or what they call the third eye, or the pineal gland, is actually a self-sense. It's the ability to really monitor self.
Yeah.
Because the moment in intention, which is self-tension, self-energy, becomes attention, becomes outer-focused, we lose the center. We lose center. You know, it's like concentration means around the center. Then we're distracted into, and so the skill becomes how to really self. It's self managed, but the word manage is wrong. It's more like how to self dance. You know, because we've seen this, that it's almost like a dance becoming back like a kind of a orb or light being, and moving through and beyond space and time is like a dance. It's a dance into where there is ever less ups and downs, you know, which is where you get like this disjointed. So it's a dance, but so you become ever more able to dance yourself. See, that's where the action becomes in consciousness. It's no more very much out there, you know, like fixing the organization.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's that coming back to the wholeness, as you talked about so often, you know, become, you know, in congruence, in resonance with the wave rather than the particles.
Right.
You mentioned the word separation, disjointedness. Absolutely,
right.
Where there's more rhythm, flow, alignment, synchronicity
yes.
in our life. These key words, as we're listening, you know, to what you're sharing, is what I hope that we can take away and
yeah.
really feel out. Because again, it's feel out. Don't just trust the outside. Don't look for answers outside. Feel them out for you. And how that translates for you into your own personal understanding and such. So, wow, Dimitri, thank you so very, very much. So many fascinating aspects, again, like I said, and so much to leave us with to, again, make sense of ourselves, the nature of reality, and also work with the power of our dreams. And in this case, we were talking about collective dreams.
People need to know that the collective dreams is not dreaming in the Western sense, you know, it's really reconnecting to a deeper dimension in nature. And I had a dream, if you don't, once where I passed a tree. I just want to show you what happens at these levels. And all of a sudden, I just stopped, because you're going to start to like look at the world, but there's like something deeper looking at it. You know, this. So the self becomes like really awake, you know, and the self like knows everything. And I was just looking at this tree, and I could. The idea was that I could, was just seeing how beautiful it was. It was, and I couldn't like. And then all of a sudden, the tree started to like move, bent over, and it started to caress my face. And what I'm saying is that we are. This deeper dreaming is really transitioning into a much deeper relationship with nature, where probably what we now see as trees is not even trees. You know, they're living conscious beings and spirits, elementals. So it's really going, the collective dreaming is really, like you could say, going, this is why these indigenous people have this. And in Africa, they have this incredible connection to Mother Earth, because they are living in what we would call the collective unconscious, you know. And I think we did make this cycle for a very important reason. Everybody is waiting on us to return, because we made this shamanic descent to become self-aware. So we are bringing something very powerful to the universe, because only by separating from that original oneness that we are returning to now, we could see self. You know, so we are the shamans of the universe. You know, we really are the leaders. We are going to herald in a whole new creation for the whole universe. That's how great we are, in a humble way of saying it.
Absolutely. One of the group, you know, things I share on this topic too so often is that right now our biggest problem really is not understanding or coming to grips with our potential. We don't realize how absolutely magnificent we are, and how, again, we are truly creators of our personal and collective realities. And so, of course, a lot of the fears that you mentioned also, whether on the internet or in personal lives, set in, and we start to believe the illusions that we live, but truly life is so much beyond that. Where we're going is so beyond that. So,
yes.
Exciting times, Dimitri.
It's been such a pleasure speaking to you, you know, because it's not often, you know, that you get to share with someone that really understands this, you know, and I really appreciate it, and it's a wonderful opportunity to share, because it's so important, you know, that people get what this version of the story. So I want to thank you also.
You're so very welcome, and Dimitri, again, thank you so much for the work that you're doing, and likewise, I appreciate, you know, the alignment, the resonance, the coherence myself, and also invite others in our audience too, that if you resonate with something, great, you know, stick with it, work with it however you see fit. If you don't, just move on, find what you resonate with, because again, so many of us waste so much energy on things we don't resonate with, rather than focusing and realizing the power and potential when we do resonate. So it's, you know, this connection goes beyond being like-minded. It's like-hearted, it's like energetically, etc. So thank you also for sharing that as well.
Thank you.
And for everyone in our audience, again, for whoever might be new to your work, I highly recommend starting with the Dimitri Halley Center or DimitriHalleyCenter.com online. Dimitri also shares fantastic regular messages and lots of insight on Facebook, so you can connect with him there, as well as on YouTube, and share in more of these messages in video format directly from Dimitri himself. Thank you everyone for joining us, and until next time.